name is Bob Olson. For 12 years before I retired, I worked in the remediation business here in Virginia. I've seen the shortcomings of some of the testing methods that DEQ has been able to use. According to one of the latest white papers published on the subject of testing, which is called Suitability of Leaching Test Methods for Fly Ash and Slide Ash Pay Review. It was published in July of 2015. The tests that we use are designed to simulate the release under specific environmental scenarios are limited because most often they do not provide information on the release under the existing environmental scenarios. They're different from the ones that are being simulated. This type of limitation has led to widespread misuse and misinterpretation of the results. Reliance on simulation-based testing can also result in treatment processes that are designed to, quote, and this is from the article, not from me, pass the test, unquote, rather than improve the waste characteristics or reducing leaching under actual use or disposal scenarios. The three extraction procedures used for fly ash are namely EP, PCLP, known as TCLIP, and ASTM. They give different concentrations of elements in the extracts of the ash samples. The EP procedure gives the highest concentration, where the ASTM gives the lowest concentration. This is indicated from a paper that was written by Bala and Kayan in 2004. The testing conducted at Dutch Gap by the three individual groups. By the way, the testing was done at three different times by Hands Across the Lake, by the James River Association, and by the Duke University, have shown high levels of contaminants. While Dominion's testing shows no problem, we are in impasse. Different test methods, different results. But the health and the welfare of the citizens of Virginia should not be decided by the most economically tested method, but by the best test method available. I would suggest to this board, we have an expert right here in Virginia who we can go to, Dr. Mark Edwards, who is a nationally renowned expert in municipal water quality at Virginia Tech. I believe this board should go to Dr. Edwards and have Dr. Edwards present to the board what is the best method for testing to ensure the health and safety of the citizens of Virginia. One other issue that came up here today and was brought up by DEQ and Dominion Power, and that's how they take the this permit, since, I don't know if this board is aware, but since 2008, and only stopped recently in 2015, that Dominion Power has been hauling fly ash from other locations, other power plants, into the Dutch Gas Power Plant. This was under the Batesies permit, not under solid waste. So therefore, you need to look at that issue. Was it done properly? Why was safety, which is supposed to be for industrial release permit, why was LIAC hauled in specifically from Southampton Power Station, Hopewell Power Station, and the Mecklenburg Power Station? Why was it hauled in under the safety permit and it should have been done under the power station?
Thank you. I
wrong with the regulations, wrong with our standards, wrong with our permitting process, and especially wrong that we could lose the Atlantic excursion in the James, in the part of the James, to the technicality. It's wrong to leave so much, too much, of the protection of our precious rivers to the voluntary discretion of a corporation, no matter how responsible it may be. I urge you, members, and anyone in this room whose work or concern brings you here today, to find some courage and strength. Use what you know to strengthen Virginia's water quality permitting standards. Ensure that what we all love about Virginia is compromised no further. Here's a great safe quote from the water quality arena. We all live downstream. Well, yeah, we do. Who will fix what happened at Virginia's headwaters? You know, it can be done. Where's the will? Where I am.
Opportunities to go with the Chicago County Board of Park and Recs and paddle in that area, and I'm very concerned about this permit and the bill as well. You had some very good testimony with regard to some of the defects in this permit, and before the break, I think it was you, Mr. Dunn, who asked me to take a look at those suggestions. I hope you hear something from them today before you vote. Here's today's paper. I don't know if you saw this in the Richmond Times section. The board to decide when draining the coal ash ponds. The board to decide. That's you, okay? I've been to a lot of these meetings over many years, and I'm trying to think if there was a time when the board actually didn't do exactly what the DEQ recommended. I think you've had, perfectly today, some very clear testimony as to why you ought to send this back and ask for them to take a look at that. I mean, think about this. 2009 is when this permit was submitted and determined complete. What did they do the last 7 years to address this issue of thermal pollution? I mean, the thermal pollution problem has been a serious issue with power plants all across this country, and certainly a great discussion. And here we are 7 years later, and we're suggesting that we study it for 5 years. That's just not acceptable. I think that, as was recommended, they need to really get busy and find a way to diminish the thermal pollution that's out there. The James River, you know, is not to be, should be considered a hot tub for the Dominion Virginia Power, and who wants to paddle in a mixing zone for arson? I just think that's really ridiculous. So, really, the onus is on you. You have an opportunity today, I think, to make history, actually, by listening to some good evidence that's been presented to you by attorneys. Mr. McLean made it clear that under the law, you have that discretion. And we would urge you to take that opportunity to really send this permit back and do what's necessary. I think the other area of discretion is with regard to the implementation of these UDP standards. Why should we wait so long, 5 years, to implement a standard that could be in effect by November 2018? And again, there are opportunities in these permits, and there's a reopen clause in all these permits, so DEQ could make an extension if necessary. But we'll be pushing the, or push them to do the right thing here. Again, we've wasted 7 years. Let's not let them waste another 5. I appreciate the opportunity to testify for you today. Again, remember, you make this decision. You have the discretion. And I would urge you to exercise that discretion and see that some changes are made. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Allison.
key shortcomings of this permit as detailed in our summary comments. The thermal discharge is up to 100 feet. This proposed permit extends a variance granted 12 years ago, 2004, that is based on data provided in 2040, with little justification as to why the variance would be extended. It appears that the amendment is not used to bring in rubber cases, and that it did not go through, that it did not bring those to the motion of updating the analysis on thermal impact of the emission. This variance will allow the unit to continue pumping the stream hot water, and confirm the water is continuing. This thermal pollution can vary the local impact. Certain fish species are harmed by the impact of high water temperature. In addition to the direct effects from the heat, the increased water temperature decreases the amount of dissolved oxygen in the water. That makes it hard for fish to survive. Second, the water intake. At the other end of the cooling water system are five water intake structures. These structures hold about 1 billion gallons of water every day, also as common as by others. As the water is sucked in at high speed and high pressure, fish and other organisms in the water are pulled into the system and are killed. Federal law requires companies to ensure that the potential harm of the cooling water system to aquatic life, and particularly to invasive species, is reduced down to levels commensurate with the performance of the subject and how it can be implemented. For instance, the current draft permit provides for nowhere near the level of attention of aquatic life as would a closed segment. There are also other options available that would provide significantly less than other alternatives that are available and should be evaluated, that may be cheaper but still significant improvements upon this current situation. We understand that there is a documented death of 2 instances of an excursion as a result of an invasive species in October of 2020 for impinged on the invasive structure. The discovery of the old survey spawning a testimony to the testicles and a total confidence to update its bylaws from 7 to 8 required federal. The DEQ did not push for better protection of our water. It is your responsibility to